Good evening, folks. It's a special midweek episode of the Piston Broke Podcast. Tonight, I'm joined by a man that barely needs any sort of introduction. He is an absolute legend in the UK wrestling scene and beyond. Ricky Knight, it's a privilege to have you here and welcome to the crazy world of Piston Broke.
It's a pleasure to be here, buddy. Great pleasure. And see you all, and hope you all had a good day.
Yeah, it's good. And a bit of a kind of busy day at work, but we're not here to talk about my bloody work, you know, with the criminal justice service. Piston Broke can skip on that one. But Ricky, we'll start at the beginning. What made you fall in love with the wrestling business in the first instance?
Well, the thing was, as a youngster, I always done action anyway. So my biggest thing I wanted to do was, you know, I wanted to be an actor and stuff. But when I was growing up, it was the James Mason type actors. You know, I was born probably 40 years before, because nowadays I'd have been hip, you know, I would have been one of the tough guys that we are nowadays. But in them days, you had to be more James Mason, more, you know, Moody Toff type of actors. And, you know, I struggled to break in. So obviously my life took a turn, and I went away from acting for a few years. And then I got a break in the wrestling business through my tag partner, Jimmy Ocean. And when I got into it, I suddenly realised, this is entertainment. You know, this is, I can go out there and be what I want. I can make that crowd do like the old music hall, you know. I've got to meet them at hand. I can make them hate me. I can make them cheer me. You know, I can make them do anything I want to. It's amazing. And after the first two or three months, I was smitten. That was it. I loved it. And, you know, as a youngster, I used to go to the wrestling at Potter's Bar and place like that. And Jackie Palo was my hero when I was a kid growing up. But it was just getting into the business. I didn't realise what the business was at that time. But when I got into it, I thought, this suits me. A good tear up and an entertainment. I was born for this job, and I've loved it ever since, and it's 36 years.
Brilliant, brilliant. Who was it that trained you initially?
And so I started with Jimmy Ocean. I was working at a nightclub in Kingsland, about, and it was a bit like the film Roadhouse. It was a very, very tough place. We had metal doors a lot. It was, you know, it was like every night. There was fighting all the time. Anyway, this particular night, a load of guys turned up with all the flat noses and the colliers. And I thought, God, it's not going to be trouble. So I said, look, you can't come in, lads. It's a members club. You know, the old story you give them just to get rid of them. And one of the lads, like Jimmy Ocean, said, look, mate, we're wrestlers. We've just come from the Corn Exchange in Kingsland. All we want is a late drink. Won't it cause no problem? So as I was the head doorman, that was my decision. I said, okay. I said, boys, let them in. We let them in. They're as good as gold, obviously. And Jimmy Ocean came up to me and was talking to me all night. And by the end of the night, he was saying about what I'd be interested in wrestling. And well, I said, I've always liked it since a kid. Never thought nothing more about it. Because obviously they left. 2 weeks later, I went to his house in Norwich, where my friend lived, and walked in the door. He was sitting on the sofa with Jimmy Ocean, the wrestler. And he was looking there, and he said, look, I'm just going down to Norwich Court for a wrestling, and I'm going to do a bit of training. Would you like to come along? So I went along. We'd done about 3 hours, and Jimmy said, mate, you're a nat. You want to give the business a go? I'll train you up, which he did. And the rest is history. Within 2 or 3 years, we the British Tag Team Champion event and all over the Great Britain, and life was good. And yeah, it was that's a chance meeting at the nightclub. But
so how long was it between starting off with Jimmy to starting WAW?
Well, I started with Jimmy, and then we started WAW. I started with Jimmy, I'd have been mid-80s, started to train. And we started, we actually started WAW in 1993, but our first show was in January 1994, called the War of 94. So that was for maybe 9 years. Me, Jimmy, and my wife, Julia, Soraya, we started it all together. And that's when we started, because we just got a bit disillusioned the way the companies were going. Because you remember, at one time, British wrestling was basically on its arse.
Yep.
And promoters were putting championship matches on first. And the biggest kick in the arse for me was me and Jimmy become tag team champions in 1990 in front of 1,000 people at Colston Hall, Bristol, and there was no belts. And I'm thinking, this is what British do. We just won the biggest. Yeah. I mean, them days, Japan, America, all the continents recognised all the British champions, you know, because there's only two companies then, All Star and the Crabtrees. So all around the world, you were known as like the tag team champions. But there was no belts. So me and Jimmy went home very disillusioned. You know, we'd done 46 minutes with a team called Ben and McCoy. And at the end of it, we were generally happy. You know, the company chose us to represent them as the tag team with no belts. So we went away and had the belts made. And then me and Jimmy on the way home says, this can't be right. You know, we've got to sort this out. So we decided to start our own company and train our own guys and try and put things back to where it was. And like a championship match was always a main event. It still is. We still have the national anthems and it's still treated like a major, major event. And I think that was a lot harder in them days. People, because it got on, the promoters went, oh, sod it, we'll just do this. We'll get 10 wrestlers in the room, we'll tell them who they're on with. And you know, you go and do G's and think you'll go back again, it never happened. And it was very disillusioned at the time. But as I said, we started our own company and we made things better. You know, made championship matches worthwhile and stuff like that. And people earned their spot. We trained people, they earned their spot and stuff like that. And when we done a G, we made sure it was followed up for the fans. I mean, fans got so disillusioned. I remember Norwich one time that Kendo Nagasaki and Haystacks done a big G, and all the fans are so excited, they're buzzing. Came round to the night, none of them turned up. And about 150 just walked out of the building in disgust, you know. And I thought, well, this can't be right. And this is the reason we started it, basically. And nowadays, it's basically an ego thing where people can't get a job and want to put the belts on each other. And days it's for the industry, to save the industry, which is what it was on its arse at the time.
And it certainly became, it's come on leaps and bounds since. The whole of the UK scene. But as we were speaking just before we went live, there's this sort of lost art of selling these days with a lot of guys, which is pretty sad to see. I mean, they're amazingly talented, athletic guys. And if they brought in more of the selling and the storytelling into that flippy style, they could really be onto some amazing things. But what's your take on the more sort of modern style, if you understand what I mean, you know, this kind of flippy style and almost no selling high impact moves compared to the older, I wouldn't say slower, you know, because, you know, some of the guys back in the day, they could go. They could go quick and they could go hard. But how have you seen that sort of evolution in styles in the UK over the years?
But like you say, I mean, we used to go, I mean, me and Jimmy, we used to go on with a team called the Liverpool years ago, Robbie Brookside, who is now in, you know, doing the stuff in America, Robbie and Doc Dean. The stuff we were doing was outrageous at that time, but the thing was, all flop, flip, flop. We would do dying, we would do something, we'd do a bit of technical, and then we'd go into this big sequence, you know, of what we call flip, flop now. And that'd end up with a big spot where it was to go over the top rope or something, and then we'd calm it right down again and sell again and stuff like that. And we were probably some of the first to do that style, but it was still sold in between, you know. But now they don't sell nothing to me. You know, just jump, as I said earlier, like, you know, you see it jump up from it. It's like, you know, Jake the Snake Roberts made that finishing move, you know, and stuff. And everything now is no, it's just nothing. You know, when you finish a move you want to do now, you have to think twice. You just jump up from it now. So if you get knocked out by it, like we used to years ago, you look weak. You know, and as I said, it's just no one sells it. Nobody takes a break. I mean, like, I'm not being funny. My grandson, RKJ, is one of the top players in the country at the moment. I'll say that. I don't say that. All the fans do. I mean, he works all the other promotions. And he's capable of doing that, but he still sells, you know what I mean? Because I keep saying to him, Rick, it's okay going out and doing all that stuff. But wrestling's about, you know, the good guys and the pantomime, it's theater, it's a performance, you know? And the theater and the performance bit is stopped, you know? I mean, I even stopped watching WWE and my daughter was there because they knocked all the wrestling out of her, you know? Everything was knocked out of her. And I thought, this is not my daughter. This is not the girl. It's not the girl I know what can do. And I stopped watching. I stopped doing WWE at that time. And I haven't watched it since. And as I said, my daughter was not watching it because it got so frustrating. And that's how I feel about it. And, you know, I just think fans deserve more for their ticket. They want to be involved. They want to be part of it, you know. That's why people go to Pabu the Badding. You know, he's behind you. You know, that's a British tradition. But it gets packed out because you get involved. And it's the same as wrestling. They want to be involved. They want you to pick on them in the front of the crowd. They want you to, you know, look at that old character back and stuff. You know, they want you to pick on them. They want to be there so they can give it to you, give it back. And I just feel gone. It's missing. I just think now it's just a clean cut, flip floppy job. And, it doesn't do nothing for me. I'm not saying it's not brilliant. Don't get me wrong. These guys can do some fantastic stuff. But it's not for me. And it's certainly not for my company. Don't get me wrong. RKJ, my other grandson, go out there and give you one of the matches. But I don't want every match part of my show. Yeah. My goal, I like to have each match different and build up to the main event. The main events are ones what you know should come to see. So every match we try and be different. So we might put a you know, one of these matches on, because our guys are capable of doing it, but I'd say to them, look, you know, don't forget the crowd. That's what it's all about.
Yeah. So did yourself and Julia, did you support your kids and then later your grandkids to get involved in the business, you know, straight off, or were you ever sort of trying to discourage them and say, look, no, it's a tough game?
I mean, like, careful. The thing is, as I said, it's just like, and I've never had to well, the only one who didn't want to do it was Paige, you know, Soraya. She never wanted to do it. And it, as it said, anyone seen the movie, it was, we were short one night and I put her in and, you know, begged her to go in there, give her good money to go in there, a woman, and then she got the bug. But all the others, it's a family tradition. As soon as they're old enough, like Zach's just had a new baby, he's about 4 weeks old now. At 2 weeks old, he laid her in the ring, and that's a night tradition now. All the grandkids go into the ring as soon as possible and stuff. And, you know, my great-grandchildren are in the kids' club, and they love it, and it helps them and stuff. And but we never said to them, come do the wrestling. You know, Roy's son is a footballer. He's already signed for Norwich City. He's only 7, so he's going in a different direction. Even though he's wrestling, we've actually said to him, look, take the foot direction, son. It's going to make you more money. So, yeah, as I said, if they want to do it, all well and good. If we don't, you know, that's fine with us, you know.
Yeah, brilliant. It's absolutely brilliant. So you mentioned there about the movie. How did that come about? I know, obviously, you know, movies have got a certain sort of procedure in place before they start getting the productions begin, but were you guys involved from the beginning, or were you more sort of just told about it later on?
Well, no, the thing was they done the pre-documentary first, Fight My Family, which is shown on Channel 4, and the first message we got was that The Rock, which is a true story, was in UK filming. And he was in a hotel one night and he couldn't sleep. So he put Channel 4 on, or documentary was being replayed, and he watched it start to finish, and he loved it. And he showed his mum, he showed his family, because they were like us, a wrestling family, and his family loved it, and he just couldn't get it out of his mind. So he then went to Vince McMahon and some other producers had a good movie. So they all got together, and he worked with the producer. Had worked with Steve Merchant before. So Steve Merchant got on the bandwagon and said, yes, he'd direct it. Well, next thing I know, I get a message from Steve Merchant saying, could he come to our training school and talk to us? He ended up spending 3 days down here. Little did we know, he was writing everything down for the script in the future, because he wrote all that in 3 days, and all that the film was written in 3 days. And then I get a phone call from my daughter to say, look, I've just spoke to The Rock. She said about, you know, getting titles and stuff, and who's your boss? And that's when I went, be without Ray, talking bollocks, you know. And even that was in the movie, I wasn't talking to The Rock, I was talking to my daughter when she rang me. I said, nah, Ray, you're talking bollocks, you're talking, you know, this is not happening. I've heard all this before, it's a joke. No, Dad, what are you going to do it? They want us to do it, this, that, and the other. And that's how it came about. And then Steve got to us, and the Lionsgate people, and next thing I know, we're taking down to London, so they could start training the actors, and that's how it all started, really. Yeah.
Ah, great stuff. So, how did you feel, you know, after the release of the movie? How did you feel with the, you know, the sort of public opinion? It was,
to be honest, we went to a private preview, and I went down there, and I was expecting the worst, to be honest, because, like, you know, in the 36 years I've been doing wrestling, me and Jules must have done 25 documentaries. We've done every chat show there is on ITV and BBC. And half the time, they take the piss, you know. So I wasn't expecting stuff in the movie, to be honest. There's a couple of things I wanted changed, and Steve Merchant was great, he changed. And when I seen the movie, I thought, yeah, this is great. It's entertaining, which it is. It's got Hollywood in it. A lot of Hollywood in it as well. But the basic story is very, and in the words of the old Eric Morecambe, you know what I mean? It's all true, you know, all the right notes, but not necessarily in the right order, was the same about the movie. Everything there was basically true, but not in the order they put it in, you know what I mean? So, yeah, I was happy with it. I was 85% of it was based on real fact, and 15% was Hollywood. Especially when The Rock got involved, he's pure Hollywood, isn't he? So, I was pleased with it. And the reception we got, Rotten Tomatoes, 92% rate, which is amazing. And all the critics and stuff and festivals, it went down a storm. So we had to be proud of it in the end.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. Did you get the chance to get the boy Merchant into the ring and maybe stretch him a little bit, throw him around for a wee while, show him what it takes?
To be honest, he came to the show, one of our shows, and we were doing the match, the CIA sort of hardcore match, and he could not believe it. Now, it wasn't originally going to be in the movie, but he went, I have to put that in the movie. I've never seen nothing like that in my life. And he hadn't seen a crowd reaction like that, because wrestling crowds are very different than theatre and that, you know. Especially in Norwich crowds, they can be very, very loud and very, full on. And he just said it, and that did go in there, and he was just amazed what we'd done. I'll just give you an example. He was here. You talk about promo. We had to do a promo with the hooligans in this underpass. And it's a bit like the old, you know, West Side Story, the gang clash in the underpass. So we've done it, and we've done it in one take. It took 10 minutes. And Steve Merchant went, he said, I can't believe it. I said, why? He said, on a film set, that would have took nearly all day, that one set. We would have gone over it about 20, 30 times. I just said, done it in one take. And I said, but that's how wrestling is. We we haven't got the stuff for the WWE or the film industry. We can't waste time. We can't afford all the big cameras. We have to get things right, get it right quick. And that's what makes wrestling so different. We have to think on our feet all the time, act on our feet. And he was so impressed by that. He walked away very impressed. I thought, that's me. We were actually impressed, and you know what I mean, which is great. That's what I'm saying about the promos that with wrestling. It does amaze people how we do it.
It was always one of my favourite things was promos.
Yeah.
But as you mentioned,
so we do a lot of promo classes at the Performance Centre. And my daughter's learned off one of the best, Dusty Rhodes, when she was in SCW. And Dusty was the top man there. Mm-hmm. And but I got to know him from my daughter, and we used to do stuff where he'd ring me up for a promo and cockney rhyming, slang, all this sort of stuff. And he got me to do a promo like London one for one of the wrestlers, a bit like Mickey out of the Rock films. He wanted me to do promos for that. And it was amazing because I think Dusty was one of the best promo men ever. You know what I mean? I loved him to pieces, and and he really looked after my daughter. So it was great that, you know, you could impress Dusty right with the promo. It was fantastic.
I was lucky enough to learn a lot about promos from Rowdy Roddy Piper.
Yeah.
He was over. Yeah, he's one of the best guys on the mic ever.
He could rile
a place up. He wouldn't even need to so much as throw a punch in the ring. He would just open his mouth and he would get reactions to tens of thousands of people. It was brilliant that way. And as you said earlier, a live audience, a good live audience, can make your job infinitely easier when you're in the ring. But something I also loved was getting to rib the boys. You know, you could play little jokes backstage on each other, sort of wind each other up. Mm. There's been a few good ones over the years, but are you getting any good stories about winding the boys up, ribbing the talent backstage?
Well, yeah, it's just the same old ones, really. You know, doing the briefcases and changing the numbers and the old bananas in the old boots and stuff and glue in the boots. And everyone in them days used to wear undertrunks. So that'd be while they're out of the room, itchy pad in the undertrunks. You know, all the old famous ones. This is how it was. And if you'd done that, you'd be down to bullion, you know. Mm-hmm. It was called having a laugh, but now it's all gone out of it. It's out as bullion. I mean, you know, we go on the camps now. In my day, we go out the camps. You do your day's job, sometimes four or five jobs in a day. You get to the bar at night and get the thing down, you know, a real good laugh. Now they just want to stay in the tuna and they just want to do this. And, you know, you're so, with all this stuff going on, man, people are so scared to do anything or say anything because it's down to bullying. You know, as I say, what we should say in our day was a laugh. Like you would say, we was having a laugh or it was just, you know, people playing tricks. It's now down as book, sadly. And that's another thing, what's going out of business, you can't have a good time them all without worrying that someone's going on Twitter and talk bollocks about you, you know. That's another sad indictment of wrestling nowadays, unfortunately.
Well, what was your take on the whole speaking out movement?
Well, you know, I've got to say, as someone who's whose wife fight about by girls that lived in my house and I looked after and I treated them as my daughter. And I nearly lost my wife over it. People don't realise that my wife went down at 5.5 stone, didn't want to be all over a tissue of lies. Now, to me, you know, speak out. Of course, if you've been sick or you've been raped, don't speak out. Don't go on Twitter, go to the police station. That's what I said to everybody who made accusations against me and my wife. I've got a police station 5 minutes walk from me. I said to them, I'll be there 7:30 tonight. You got complaints against me or any of my family, just call that police station and I'll be there waiting for you to do it. Nobody called because it's easy to go on Twitch and cause trouble with someone you don't like. But let's stick to facts. Let's stick to the fact that you might have been raped. Go to the police. Get this guy nicked. Let's stick to the fact that you might be sexually assaulted. Go to the police. What do you achieve by going on Twitter? You know? And one of these girls who spoke out, she lived with me for 3 years, lived in my house. I took her from a heroin addict, put her on the straight and narrow. I got a WWE trials, and you say no once to somebody, you turn villain, But if you live in my house, you live under my rules, the same as my children. You understand what I'm saying? But some people don't respect that. That's what I'm saying about nowadays, about having a laugh with people. You think, are we having a laugh, or are they going to be on Twitter? And this is what you've got to think about these days. But what I don't realise is the effect they have on people, like I did on my wife. I could never, ever forgive them for that. And there's only hundreds of messages all over the world to my wife, and so full of flowers. I've never seen that in my life. That me and my wife actually took to the local cemetery to put them on graves where I had no flowers on. That's how much support my family got from around the world. And I said to my wife, you've got to pick yourself up, sweetheart. There's six people there who've got a reason to have a grievance running on bullshit. But you've got thousands of people around the world who send you love. You do training schools in America. You've done training schools in Canada, Europe. Worldwide, nobody spoke out about you except these little girls with a bit of a grievance. And then she realised the world loves her, But for that time, I could have lost my wife. So to me, that's speaking out. If you're going to speak out, you've got a serious case, go to the police. That's where it belongs. Not on Twitter, not talking to other girls in the business. Your personal problems, you go to the police. Simple, straightforward as. And if it's a real problem, you would go to the police, That's the bottom line. Oh, yeah, that's my take on it.
Well, can it brighten things up a wee bit with you've got a show coming back up? Is it the 22nd?
Yeah, Saturday, yeah.
Yep, is that in your... give us the details, you pimped the show out.
Yeah, well, it's at the our performance centre. It's something we just moved into before the pandemic. It's going to be a one-stop shop. We're going to run all our shows from there. We've invited other companies to run their shows from there. It's not just about WAW. It's about British wrestling. I'm a British wrestling man. I'm not just about WAW, Whenever I've had TV programs, I've shared it with other companies. And stuff. We're all about sharing. My biggest thing is I want to get a border control going, but it's so hard. I'm just sidetracking for a minute because if we'd had a border control, none of us would be suffering like we are now. Because action's got a border control. Even badminton, tennis, everybody got money during the pandemic. We didn't because we've got no border control. Because what the government do, they hand the money to the border control, who then hand it down to the people who need it. So like the badminton people go, well, that Leicester badminton club needs it, or Fulham badminton club needs it, and that's how it gets. But because we had none of that, we got nothing. We got left behind. So all the companies have struggled, especially us. We've lost 350,000 in this last year. Nobody's given me that back. But we had a border control, we'd have been fed from the government to help us out. Yeah. That's the thing. But getting back to the show, I digress. Getting back to the show, it's our place, a new place. We've got this great place. We've got the entranceway. We've got 18-foot ring up. We've got a bar license. We've got everything there. It can hold 400 people comfortably. It's got good views everywhere. And as I said, it's open to other companies. And we've got the boxing there in August. The boxing is starting to come to us. And it's a place on the edge of the city. There's no houses we can upset. It's on an industrial estate. We've got a big car park. It is the ideal thing for wrestling. And it's something that I've dreamed about since I started WAW. And I'm living the dream. We've got a place where we're living the dream. And it's going to be up to other things as well. We've got the license to run shows, to run weddings, to do everything there. So it's going to be an entertainment place for the whole city, not just for wrestling. And we're just so excited for it. And just as I came on the phone, Zach's been approached by a couple of good sponsors who want to come in with us. So at the moment, everything's on the right road. As I said, it's our first show Saturday night, and we're getting ready for that now, and everyone's really excited.
Brilliant, brilliant. Because it's been a long, long time since shows have been, you know, a thing. It feels like forever without being able to play shows.
We've got a health and safety officer on board who's guiding us all through this stuff, and it costs a lot of money. He's got all our COVID certificates, we've got this and that and the other. And I think it was August, September, we were allowed to run some shows. We were only allowed 70 people in, but we run them anyway because to keep our guys going. But we had to, the tracing stuff. We've got the sign in, they wear the mask, they do this, they do that. And we run, I think it was about 12 shows in all before we shut down again. And we had not one case come out of our venue. So this shows that if you do things right, you listen to the right people, places can run. And I think we proved it by running them shows and not getting one case, because we had a track and trace, nothing come back to us, any show. So, you know, that's my point. We could do that, and it can be done properly.
Yeah. So do you have the contracts back in place for the holiday camp shows for this summer? And is that still maybe
I've already got about 100 camps in. We've got some next weekend, all being well. And, they're starting to come back in. A lot of them are, we've got another 100, they're waiting to see what happened, but they'll all come back to us. And hopefully, I think some of them are going to be late this year, because I take some off All-Star Promotions. I help him out, Brian Dixon. Mm-hmm. And I'll do the local ones around here. And I think they're going to be later this year, maybe September time. But yeah, everything's coming back in place. Money's starting to come back in. And now we just want to get on with it without no more interference from the government, hopefully. So yeah, everything's looking good.
Have you taken the chance to perhaps maybe shake up your WAW roster a little bit after the last, 16 months or whatever, everybody being sort of off and, on the downside, not getting any shows? You get a chance to get some new faces in, returning some old faces?
Well, to be honest, I talked with the boys, Zach and Roy, the other day. We've got a weekend coming up in June, and we're busy now trying to bring in other talent from away. I want to keep our guys on their feet, because it's so easy. If you're going to get a show, we've got academy shows, we've got the what we call the elite shows, the Bellatrix girl shows every month.
Yep.
So they start getting guaranteed shows every month, I don't want to get lazy. And that's not being nasty. Let's keep trying to be the best we can. I want to bring in the away guys, secondly, because there's a lot of good talent out there. Another reason, I want our guys to work other people rather than keep working each other and get comfortable. Bringing outsiders in, I believe, helps a lot, mm-hmm. And we do that, and that's what we're hoping to do on the June show. We're sitting down now with Zach and Roy and seeing what talent's out there. If there's any out there want to be considered, just email us at waw1994@hotmail.co.uk. And send us over your resume, and we'll have a look at it, because we are definitely looking for new talent. And as I said, we're also, if you want to run a show from our venue, we've got no problem with that. We're for British wrestling, and not just WAW.
Well, what about what's your views on booking an international talent, like some big name American guy that's maybe not wrestled a match in 10 years, but he's still got a name that's a bit of a draw?
Well, to be honest, when we run Epic Studios, which is, we've done it quite a lot, we've done really well down there. And last year I done a Pontins Weekender, which Pontins paid me for, what Butlins have been doing for years. Hunters wanted to do it. So we brought in Billy Gunn, we brought in Booker T, and we brought in Foley, you know.
Yep.
And they done the job, because I don't think we'd have sold out the weekend without them. But a lot of, you know, Epic Studios, we've done the same. But also it gives us a chance to build our guys up, because crowds were coming in to see these American guys. Whether we like it or not, they were still the draw. But then when we decided to run some shows with just our talent, we were equaling their crowds and sometimes beating their crowds, because we'd introduce the fans to our talent that they hadn't seen before and got to like them and knew they could see them every week, and they were buying their T-shirts and buying their pictures and stuff. So it works both ways, really. And to be fair, you know, Scott Hall, he was brilliant. You know, he helped build our brand down Epic Studios. Fantastic. Whatever you say about Scott, he's got a fantastic brain. I love him to bits. We clash. We do clash with Scott. Same as me and Jake. But, he's like a brother. So is Jake. And they both, whenever they come for me, done the business for me. And Jake the Snake, when I used him, I lived on him, his crowds, for 2 years after. You understand what I'm saying? By him bringing the crowds to me, they kept coming back, even when Jake had gone home. So they'd done what they were there for. So some of them I've got no problem with, you know. If someone who come over and still think they mean everything and want to dominate the show or dominate the dressing room, and I have to tell them straight, you know, you'll be getting a flight home. It don't work that way here, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You're part of my roster, you're part of my gang. You know, if I tell you to go out in the grass skirt, I'm the promoter, I'm paying you exorbitant money, you do as you're told, and that's how I am. If they don't like it, they don't come, but they still come back, so they must like the way I work.
That's it, that's it. Hopefully the fans are enjoying it too.
Yeah.
But are you hoping then it's just got, you're going to be back as quickly as possible to just, you know, running these regular shows again, getting the income back, getting the fans content?
Somebody got to my wife again. Somebody come to the door. Sorry. Just, can you repeat the question?
Yeah. No problem. It's getting the shows back in, getting the regular income, and getting the fans in the areas that you're working happy again.
Yeah.
Because that was one thing I always missed about wrestling, is that fan interaction. Even playing heel.
Yeah.
Seeing a young guy, a young kid, booing their heart out or cheering their heart out, whatever it might be, and, you know, get to the main event of the night, the baby face goes over, there's a big crowd pop, everybody's cheering, and the crowd goes home happy. That's one of the things I really miss.
Yeah. You're on my way, right? I'm on my page, buddy, because, as I said, to me, it's all about the crowd. I was talking to my son, Zach, who was in the office, and we talked about this, and I said, listen, if I say I'll come up for your promotion, and you give me £1,000, that'd be a lovely wage packet for me. But at the end of my match, we didn't get the reaction that you, the promoter, wanted, and what I wanted, that £1,000 wouldn't mean shit to me, because I'm there because I love wrestling. I'm there because I love entertaining, and I want to get that storyline over to perfection. So if you give me £1,000, I'll come over with £1,000 pocket. I wouldn't be happy. The money would be handy to pay my bills, but it wouldn't help me up here where I thought I'd failed to do the job that I was paid for. Mm-hmm. Unless that crowd is reacting the way that me and you want it to react. You as a promoter, me as a wrestler, I haven't done my job, simple as. And that's what I said to my son the other day. That's what it's all about to me. Money's secondary. I love the business. It's nice to be paid for something you love doing. I've been lucky. I've been wrestling 36 years as a professional. I never took another job. Maybe a few bouncing jobs here and there, but predominantly I've been a wrestler for 30-odd years, and I've enjoyed every moment of it. And tomorrow morning I'll get up and walk in my PC centre, and I'm happy as a sandboy. I'm going to work. Most people get up tomorrow and think, oh, fuck me, I've got to go to work this morning, you know? Because I'm ready to go, I've got to work, lovely, and I don't want to come home. My missus has dragged me out of there. And that's been fantastic to me. I love it, and I still love it.
Fantastic. But over 30 years in the business, it takes its toll on your body.
Mm.
So if you want to go sort of head to toe, the things that's happened to you over the years, you know, injuries you've picked up, aches and pains. I know what it's like. I mean, I'm 42, and sometimes I feel like I'm in the body of a man twice my age.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I think when you're not wrestling, it's when you ache more. I find that when I'm on the camps, I'm mobile, or I'm on the road for 2 or 3 weeks at a time, and I'm mobile, I'm great. As soon as this last year, sitting about, it's been terrible. Like, I tried to just jump on the stage we built today, and it's like, I ain't going to do this because my legs are so stiff. So, yeah, it's been a massive thing. But most of it, I've been lucky. My wife's had far more injuries than me. But you see, all my teeth have been knocked out. It's not because I've had that. It's because I've been knocked out. I always seem to take these, I don't know, I've always had facial injuries, you know, my nose or my cheeks or this and that and the other. I think a lot of it's the old tag days when, you know, your tag partner do something and the baby face would move and they catch you or whatever. But, you know, I can name every 2 foot taken out by every opponent. So I certainly miss, I better go on Twitch and start moaning on Twitter and start moaning about it. But no, but I'm saying, yeah, the worst one I had was when I ripped my calf off my bone. I was out for nearly, well, getting over 2 years with that, you know, and that was the worst one. But I said, I've had the usual broken fingers, you know, the colliers and stuff and stuff like that. But, you know, my wife's had the most horrendous one. She's been blinded. She's broken nearly every bone in her body. She's, you know, just her wrists, her collarbones, her knees, her ankles. She's had some horrendous injuries. And I've been very lucky in comparison to her. I mean, you know, she's been, I think it's come on, maybe I'm well padded. She's not, but she's really had some real dodgy ones. And the blinding was the most horrendous one. She was blind for 6 weeks. And we didn't know if she was going to get a sight back or not. But yeah. So yeah, people say, oh, it's all this and that and the other. It is. We're not designed that, but it's also bloody dangerous if you don't get it right. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And to be, you know, you're a professional, because it's like watching a snooker player. It looks easy until you've got a snooker table or a dart player. So we watch two wrestlers in action. It looks easy. So people think they can do it in the street or in the front room. It don't work like that. We're fully trained and we go out there and we do what we do, but even we can make mistakes and even we can get hurt. Yeah. And that's why people don't get it. When we get trainees come down, they get the idea it's all predetermined, it's all being first training school, and they think, oh, I've got a bad back. Yeah, well, it's going to be like this the rest of your life, son. This is how it's going to be. You know, so don't believe all the hype.
Yeah. I remember coaching a session, and there was a couple of young guys, maybe 15, 16 years old, something like that. They're sort of fresh in the door. And I was like, right, I'm going to get you taking just basic back bumps. And I had some bumping solid. I had them on crash mats to start with, just to get the basic technique down. And, you know, they would sort of move on to sort of smaller mats. And then eventually, I says, right, I'll give you a shot in the ring. And the only reason I'm letting you in there is just to show you how it feels, because it's not a fucking trampoline.
That's right.
You know, and these guys, because usually something on their first day, I wouldn't have them anywhere near a ring. You know, they're working in the mats. And if they don't like it, tough. No. I got the boys in. I says, right, ready. They were doing their basics, are back bumps, side bumps, front flips, things like that. You know, just kind of basic stuff. And these guys, they were getting up like a flaming 80-year-old man.
Yeah.
I said, have you forgotten everything I've taught you in the last 2 hours from out in the mats to into the ring? You know, it's like they couldn't get their head around, I'm telling them the safety aspects of this for a reason.
Yeah.
You know, and it ended up, you know, one of the kids spat the dummy and says, it was after a couple of weeks, he goes, I've not even learned a suplex yet. I said, out.
Exactly.
If that's your attitude, just go. But you've had a lot of guys coming through your training school over the years. Is it the longest running training school in the UK, if not?
It is, yeah. We was about before Hammerlock, to be fair. As I said, you know, obviously we've got Nick Aldis, who was a big achievement for us. Obviously Paige, Kip Sabian, AEW, one of our guys, and now Anthony Ogogo, who's just making his thing on there, the boxing lad.
Yeah.
To be honest, I don't watch it. I'll get told by my board and my lads. But Anthony's a lovely lad, and yeah, I hope he does very well. But these are obviously the big guys that we've done. But we've got the UK pit bulls. We've got all these other guys that we've trained over the years and made a good living out of it. So yeah, we've achieved quite a lot, and I'm happy the way things are going. And I think we've got a couple of lovely lads down there. One day he's going to get to the big leagues as well. So yeah, I think we'll still keep surprising. There's some more to come off our academy yet. You know, I'm sure of it.
Great stuff. So, what's next for the Knight family as a whole?
Well, as a whole, as I said, we've got this little thing, but Zach was actually having trials when the pandemic broke out in America. He's actually out there with my grandson, RKJ, and they sent him home. So once the pandemic's over, I think they'll be going back to finish their trials. So I'm hoping that Zach might get the break at last that he deserved, because I know he's my son, but he's one of the most talented ones I know. He's one of the best mic men in the business. Every American who comes there picks up on Zach and says he's one of the best they've seen at such a young age and stuff. And he knows the business inside out, you know, and he's training, the way he trains. I don't know if you've seen his documentary, have you, for the kids stepping into the ring? I mean, the stuff he does for them kids, it's just amazing. And we were doing stuff with naughty kids in lockdown schools. We were going around there, and Zach had them eating out of his hands, the patience he showed. He was there driving me nuts because they were cheeky little sods and that, you know what I mean? And, you know, but Zach had so much patience with them, and we got a diploma from the government for the work we've done there. So I think if Zach don't make it to the America, he's always going to have a role in the business as one of the, you know, the coaches who can bring the best out of people. I mean, I've got a friend in Australia who was very friendly. He's in a wheelchair, ex-wrestler. And Zach has said to him, one day me and Dad are going to come over there and we're going to do a wheelchair if I can match. And the guy was laughing. I said, when Zach says he can do it, he can do it. You know, he's that sort of lad. He will sort something out, and he will. And we taught that blind kid, you know, the blind kid. When he came into the gym and he said, you know, he had the white stick, and he said to me, I want to wrestle. And I'm sitting there scratching my head, and I pulled Zach over, and he went, nothing's impossible, Dad. I said, well, you know, Zach, this is going to be the biggest challenge you've ever had. But this kid is incredible. He's still wrestling with us, by the way. He's incredible. And he trusts Zach so much. And it's all about the noise and the steps. And the lads helping him with a slap here and there. But Zach's got it down to fine art. Unless you know what he's looking for, you wouldn't realise what's going on. I mean, he even got him doing the splash off the top. And I said, Zach, I couldn't imagine caught that top rope in the dark and not being out to see.
Can't touch.
But his trust in Zach is just there. And I just said, Zach, you got a gift, mate. If you don't make it WWE, you still got a gift. And his sister Paige always says to him, you're doing great stuff, Zach. Just because you ain't got thousands of people watching you every day, what you're doing in that gym is amazing. You don't need crowds to appreciate what you're doing. She's right. She's pretty true. So, yeah, and then there's Royster. Obviously, Roy's still the fittest man in the company. He's 40 now, but he's still head and shoulders above everyone in WAW for his fitness. He looks better now at 40 than he ever did at 20-odd, you know. And he's still playing a good standard of football at 40, and so he's playing tonight. So, yeah, he's doing great, as I said. And obviously, the wife is just waiting for the flights to start again, because a lot of her work is in America. People don't realise she's massive in America, my wife. She's bigger in America than she ever is here. For all the indie companies over there, she's massive, and her training schedules and all that. So, I remember Scott Hall telling me, we walked in on one of Julia's seminars in Chicago. He said, I just popped in to say hello. He said, I stood there 2 hours, mesmerized by her training techniques. And this is Scott Hall. He said, the woman is so talented when it comes. So, I think that's where Jules will end up being a coach. You got to remember, Jules is 50 this year. I don't say that out of spite. I say that out. You know, she is 50. She's still active, still wrestling. But he says to me, I don't think women can go as long as blokes. And I think she's probably right, you know. But she'll always have a job in the business because her coaching is brilliant. So we'll always have great coaches at our training school, whatever happens.
Yeah. So, yeah, just going to wind that up now, Ricky. I just say thank you very much to Ricky Knight for his time tonight. Thanks for everybody that's watched this evening, that shared the post and interacted with us. It's been an absolute pleasure sharing the night with Ricky himself.
Yeah. It's my pleasure fantastic. Too, buddy.
Got a great mind for the business, and I'd love to speak to you again if you'd be interested at some point, Ricky.
Well, let's put it this way. I'll get Scottish boys to come down here, jump in the car one day, do a seminar, and we can have a good old chat.
Yep, sounds like a plan.
How would you fancy that?
Yep.
Do you know Drew Marshall?
Yep.
Yeah, well, he comes down to me all the time. And last year we brought a Scots crew down for having England-Scotland match and stuff. So that'll be happening in the future. Maybe you'd like to come down, do a seminar with my students, show a bit of Scotch way.
Great stuff.
And then have a pint up the night with me and the family and just have a good old chat about the old days.
Sounds like a plan. If you,
that does to me.
If you hang fire just for 2 seconds, Ricky, let's end the stream and we can have a little chat. And
okay, buddy.
But I'll be back on Sunday with my friend Bill Bunting joining us all the way from Kentucky. And until then, stay Piston Broke.